Let me do Doppler effect for light first. That's actually easier. With the formalism that I introduced here. How many here know, remember is the wrong word. When I do physics 4A, I don't cover Doppler effect. So you would have need to read it in the textbook. How many here remember reading about Doppler effect when you did the sound waves? Some of you maybe. Okay, so if you're in my class, sorry, I know for a fact that I don't cover it. If you have read about, if you know anything about Doppler effect, that would be from your own reading. And let me just show you some things about Doppler effect that you may have noticed it at the time. It's quite complicated. When you look at the Doppler effect for sound waves, it's a set of formulas you have to know, and you have to be really careful with these formulas. Wait, let me first go to the correct section, and then I can just skip around. Is it in under waves? No, they might do it under sound. Okay, the Doppler effect. All right. So once you're there, I'll remove the top thing the way I know how. All right. All right. So Doppler effect, Doppler effect, Doppler effect. If you have heard of it, and I assume you've read it through all this discussion, I'm skipping it through. What I want to get to is the formula. So they give you this. And you might think, oh, so that's all I have to know. The frequency shift at the observer is given by frequency shift, frequency from the source, given by this ratio of velocities. But if you are just hunting for formulas, what you'll have to be careful is, this is the specific situation with source moving. The next paragraph. There's also a case where the observer, what is it? I may not have read this. Who's moving, source or the observer? So here the source is moving, right? So that figure I think goes with something else. Okay, here. Stationary source, moving observer, that's the formula that they derived here. And there's an entirely separate formula. When you have stationary observer, and the source is the one that's doing the moving. So when you are looking up formulas for Doppler shift, you have to get both. This for when the source is moving, when the observer is moving. So here this V is the velocity of the observer. And here where the source is moving, here the velocity is the velocity of the source. And you get two different formulas for that. Why is that? Why do we care with the Doppler shift for light? Sound. That you care. Does it make a distinction if it's the source moving or object moving or observer moving? Like physically, is there a difference between? Here I can observe a Doppler effect in two different ways. I could have a speaker that's stationary, and I could be moving, and the sound I hear will change in pitch, or the speaker can be moving, and sound that I guess all of you here will change pitch. Are those two really physically distinct? That it should result in two different formulas? Let me cast the question in a different way. Is there a special reference frame for sound? Yes, there is. And what is the special reference frame? Reference frame of the medium. It's the reference frame where there's no wind, where the air is at rest. So that's what they mean. When they say source is moving, they're saying source is moving relative to air. When they say observer is moving, they're saying observer is moving relative to air. So that's the reason for all this complexity. When you do Doppler effect in non-relativistic mechanics, that's kind of why I skip it. It seems way too complicated. You can read about it. I won't use class time. Now, we are in special relativity. In special relativity, is there a distinction between observer moving or the source moving? Yeah, now in special relativity, there is no special reference frame. So special relativity should turn out to be simpler, because when I have this laser beam, I guess it's bouncing off that and they're coming towards me, and when I say I'm moving towards it, or the beam, you know, the door is moving towards me, either way, it should result in the same effect. Same, numerically the same effect. So I want to show you a really quick derivation for Doppler shift effect. It kind of relies on a very special knowledge that I have that, you know, you guys don't yet because I haven't told you yet. But it's a very simple knowledge that I can just tell you right now. It's the fact that what's called wave number forms a four vector. So let me remind you of this. This is a mathematical expression for plane wave. This is what plane wave looks like. Plane wave. So you can describe this f as a function of position and time. You have amplitude times cosine of kx minus omega t. You all remember seeing this? Yes? Good. Now, so this was in 1D, right? One dimensions. I have only one space coordinate. Let's say I don't want to restrict myself to 1D anymore. I want to instead say, I want to describe plane wave in three dimensions. It's still a plane wave. It's still going in one direction. But I want that direction to be arbitrary. Then this is the modification I need to make. This x needs to be a vector quantity so that it can be pointing in x, y, or z direction. So this x is vector. And what that means is this wave number here, it's actually a vector quantity. And this product is the dot product. Like, this modification makes a sense. Like, you might not have known it, but once I tell you that's what it is, it kind of makes sense, question?
How can you take the cosine of a vector?
I'm not taking cosine of a vector. This dot product is a scalar.
Okay.
Yeah, that's why it's a dot product, yeah. Yeah, so what k does, this wave number does is it, when you have a displacement, you just look at the displacement along k. So this wave number is actually it's a dot product. And, k is a vector quantity. And let me tell you this. This is a Lorentz four vector. This particular combination. I hope this is actually quite suggestive. I hope the way this is written is suggestive. I have position and time here, which are components of a four vector. It's been combined with some other stuff, and I'm kind of hoping this whole thing is a Lorentz invariant. So this thing that it's multiplying to, that's going to be itself a four vector. So this is the wave number four vector. Wave number four vector, or four wave number, if you are naming it the way I named the four momentum. Then it should be something like this. The frequency is the time component, somehow. Frequency is in the time component, and the wave number is the spatial component, somehow. Now, I need to fix the unit. So this is correct in the world where your speed, you know, speed of light c is one. So let me look at the unit, the way the units work out here. So k, anybody here remember unit of wave number? What is the, how do you remember unit of wave number?
1/wavelength.
Yeah, so you remember the definition of wave number. Definition of wave number is 2π over wavelength. The important part is over the wavelength. So wave number here has unit of 1/meter. What's the unit of angular frequency? Not second, but
1/second.
Yeah, 1/second, or radians per second, but radian is the real unit. So this is 1/second. All right, so I need to turn this into that. I think I can do that by multiplying this with C. Then I'll have correct unit for both, the units that will match. Yeah? So this is a four vector. What that means is this thing that expresses property of a wave, it transforms under Lorentz transformation, like coordinates do. So let's say I have a stationary source. Let's say this is glowing. I have a stationary source, and as it glows, if I describe it, along this axis, x-axis, if I describe the wave along this axis, then these would be the frequency and the wave number I measure. Now, to get the Doppler effect, what I can do is, let's take the same wave, and let's try to describe it in the reference frame that's moving in the plus x direction. And let's see what we get. Yeah. So then let me skip the y and z component and say that we are only describing the x component of the wave number, just to make things easier for us. So I have wave frequency and wave number in the lab reference frame where the source is stationary, and the primed coordinate that I want to describe is the one that's moving to the right at speed v. So this would be gamma minus gamma beta minus gamma beta gamma. Yeah. All right, let's write it out and see. So I do the matrix product. People here remember how to do matrix product? Yes? Okay, so let me erase this and do the product here. So then my first component is gamma omega minus gamma beta ckx. Gamma beta ckx. And I guess that's actually all I need, but let me do the second one just so I have it. Second one is minus gamma beta, or let me do this first. Gamma ckx, minus gamma beta omega. Minus gamma beta omega. Good. So this is supposed to be the new frequency. Let me simplify it so that we can get some kind of an expression that we can actually compare to these. They will end up looking somewhat similar to these two expressions. So, let me write it out. Omega prime is equal to, I guess I can factor out gamma. Gamma omega minus beta c kx. I think I have kx that I don't really want. I want to rewrite it in terms of something else. If the wave is only traveling in x direction, can I rewrite kx in terms of omega? How are they related? Or do you guys remember this? C is equal to omega over k. Coming from speed of light is equal to frequency times wavelength. Seems familiar? I think that was actually on your exam question. Right? All right, so I can solve this for k. So k is equal to omega over c. Okay? So this k, let me substitute that in. That's omega over c. Oh, that's good. C's cancel out. So I have this expression, which doesn't look all that simple. Gamma times, so now I can factor out omega. Let me factor out actually omega to the front. So I have omega times gamma times 1 minus beta. And when you're just looking at that, that won't look all that simple. In particular, when you try to compare this to that, like it doesn't look like anything. So let me do this. I can actually rewrite gamma. So in terms of beta, if I do that, then it's this. Divided by square root of 1 minus beta squared, right? Let me do one more simplification. I can actually factor 1 minus beta squared. I don't do that often, but this is a valid algebra I can do. 1 minus beta squared is equal to 1 minus beta times 1 plus beta. Right? That's correct factorization of that expression. So let me do that. I don't do this often because often it doesn't really give you anything useful. But this is an exception. So let me, when I do that, I get omega times 1 minus beta. Let me rewrite it in a strange way. Square root of 1 minus beta squared. That's still fine, right? I haven't done anything wrong yet. Okay, divided by square root of this factorization, 1 minus beta times 1 plus beta. So some things actually cancel out with proper simplification. This factor of 1 minus beta cancels out with that. So you get this Doppler shift formula. So for an observer that's moving away from source, you get omega prime is equal to omega times square root of 1 minus beta over 1 plus beta. So how does the frequency change as you move away from the light source? Does your frequency increase or decrease? Decrease, right? Does that make sense? That is, if you are looking at the, so you know, if you are looking at the light, so this is green light. If I move away from that, the frequency of this light would decrease. So what would that do to the wavelength? It make the wavelength longer. So if you know it has green color right now, as you are moving away, will color shift towards the blue end or the red end? Red end, yeah. So this is called red shift. That's the kind of shift you get when you are moving away from a source. How would this change if you are instead of moving towards the source? Or source is moving towards you? It'll be blue shifted. And the only way this formula will change is you essentially replace beta with minus beta. So it'll be square root of 1 plus beta over 1 minus beta. Pretty simple correction. And so that's it. And you know, this, I guess this is the sense in which this is kind of related to this, in that here, so you don't see any square roots, right? But you do see this, the difference or addition of the source and the wave velocities, or the object and wave velocities. If you did this hypothetical calculation, you would get this result. This is the geometric mean of the classical Doppler shift, where you have two different numbers calculated. So for, you know, where the, what I was describing, you know, stationary source, observer moving away, in a case of sound wave, it actually matters that this is stationary. But you can calculate two different ways. With the, for the increasing distance, you could say it is actually stationary source, you are moving away, versus you are stationary, source is moving away. When you do those two different calculations, you get two different expressions. One of them, I guess, one of them will be this. And the other one will actually give you this. The other one should give you something that looks like, I don't know, Vs minus V over V, or something like that. So this is what I mean by geometric mean. Everyone here knows what geometric mean is? Geometric mean, average of A and B, multiply them together, take the square root. So you multiply these two together, take the square root, the result you get is this. I don't know if there's any physical meaning, it just happens to work out that way. Yeah, so that's a Doppler shift. Once you introduce the idea of four vector, it actually becomes a lot easier to derive it because just the Lorentz transformation that you've already seen.